Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven.
We are really going through the book of Matthew. You know, the Bible has the Old Testament, the New Testament, and the first book in the New Testament is the book Matthew. And we have journeyed quite a bit. We come now to Matthew chapter 5 and verse 9. But let me start with a simple story. Two kids wanted to buy a present for their mummy. They've always been hearing mummy say, "Oh, kids, I'm so tired. I really wish you guys would just give me a break. I need to have peace, I need to have some rest." So the kids felt bad and they went to buy a stock of rose for their mummy. And they passed the rose to mom, and mom took a look at the rose and she was very pleased, she was very happy. But at the same time, she saw a note, a ribbon that was stuck to the rose. And the note read like this: "Dear mom, we love you. Please rest in peace." This morning, we're going to talk about peace, because that's what Jesus spoke of in Matthew 5 and verse 9. "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God." The word peacemaker may not be a very familiar word. Some of you may say, "I'm more familiar with pacemaker than peacemaker. What in the world is a peacemaker?" Well, he has something to do with peace. But the first image that we may have is that of a counselor, that of a mediator who comes between two quarreling individuals. Maybe we think of a counselor, a mediator who comes between a husband and a wife, or someone who is coming in between two quarreling, arguing neighbors, or two colleagues at work who are at loggerheads, or even someone who comes in between settling differences between two church members. That's our idea. Now, that may be true here, but I don't really think that is the main thrust, that is the main intent of Jesus Christ when he said these words. Because I think the peacemaker here is not mediating peace between man. I think he is mediating peace between God and man. So this peacemaker is not just trying to bring two people together. This peacemaker is going about bringing God and man together. So it's not just a horizontal peace we're talking about. It's a vertical one, I think, primarily in mind in this verse. You say, why do you think so? Well, several reasons. Number one, if you look at this verse, Jesus is linking peacemaker with the sons of God. In other words, these peacemakers are the sons of God. They are the people who know God. They are the children of God. They are the people of the kingdom. They are Christians. So this peacemaking is unique for the Christian. Now, I think virtually anyone today can play the role of a mediator in the world. My son, for example, can be a mediator between two quarreling classmates. Doesn't take a Christian to do that. But you need to be a Christian in order to bring about peace between God and man. So I think this is unique. Unique for the kingdom of heaven, the people of the kingdom of heaven. Number two, if you look on at verse 10, we see that there is a persecution for that righteousness. So these people who are peacemakers will also and should also expect to be persecuted for righteousness' sake, for living that righteous life, for speaking of that righteous life, for preaching the message of righteousness. So this peacemaker, bringing in peace between God and man, expects to be persecuted. So I think this is a relationship between God and man again. So I want to encourage you, when you read the Bible, have this pair of lenses that says, when I read the Bible, I want to see God. You see, the Bible is primarily about God. We live in such a society that thinks everything revolves around me. So this piece must be about me and my friends, me and others. It's about man. But no, the Bible is supremely about God. Yes, it's a book written to man, for man, but it is really about God. So this peace is about peace with God. And this is a major teaching in the Bible. You know, when you read the Bible, you ask, what is the Bible about? Some people say the Bible is a love letter from God to us. It's a message of love. I think that's true. Some people say the Bible is a message about the coming kingdom of God. I think that's true. The kingdom motif is very clear. But another way, another theme, another perspective of the Bible is that the Bible is a message of peace. It's a story of peace, and namely, peace with God. There are more than 400 references of peace with God in the Bible, so it is a major element that you need to understand. So this morning, I want to do something. I want to share with you a story, all right? The story of the entire Bible, and it's a story of peace with God. In order to do that, I've gotten a whiteboard, and for those at the back, I know you can't see. I hope the projection here may help you understand this story of peace with God. Now, I'm not very good at drawing. But you just have to make do, okay? So let's look at this story of peace. What does the Bible teach about peace with God? The story of peace. Every story has a beginning, chapter 1. So let's go chapter 1. Chapter 1, about sweetness of this peace. Or sweet peace, if you want, all right? The sweetness of this peace. How did it begin? It begins in the Garden of Eden. God is with man in perfect peace and joy. So in the Garden of Eden, we are told God made man. And they live in perfect peace. There is no conflict, no disagreement, no war, no battle, just perfect bliss. Now, I want you to know that the idea of peace in the Bible is not just the absence of conflict, but the idea of peace in the Bible includes the presence of favor and goodwill and goodness. The word shalom in the Hebrew encapsulates all that, or captures all that. It's not just that there is no fighting, but there is blessing, there is goodwill, there is favor. And you certainly see that in the Garden of Eden. God and man lives in peace, and God is favorably disposed towards man. God is giving to man. God is supplying man. God is providing for man everything, all food, all nature, all creatures, everything he needs for a happy, satisfied, blissful life. God provides. God is with man in the Garden of Eden. So that's the idea of peace, not just the absence of conflict, but the presence of blessing. Now, I think you can be very clear about that. For example, if you go to Lim Chu Kang and you go to the cemetery, you go there at night, there is no conflict, but you may not feel very much at peace because there's not much goodwill you sense out of that. But real peace is the presence of favor and blessing and goodness from God. The idea, I think, you can see in Numbers 6, 24 to 26, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you, favorably disposed towards you, and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. So, the story of peace really begins with a very sweet note. Beautiful, God and man in blissful living. God receiving the praise of man, man receiving the beautiful provisions of God. Wonderful. It would be nice if the story ends at chapter 1. But with every good story, I suppose, there is a tension that is built up. And then we read in chapter 2, the emergence of the sabotager. There is someone who didn't like this. Someone who was upset that God and man are living in peace. He's angry that man should be so blessed. He's angry that man should so praise God. He wanted to break this all up. He wanted to bring everyone into misery and grief. He wanted this peace to be broken up and disrupted. You say, who is this man? Or not man, sorry. Who is this person? He is? Oh, thank you very much. Because first service, I got to ask like 10 times before they're willing to say. Well, you're right, absolutely right. The sabotager is none other than Satan. Now, how am I going to draw Satan? Now, this is a tough part, and it's not biblical, all right? This picture is not biblical, but I think you get the idea. Satan. The Bible didn't say he has horns, but I draw just for you to. He's upset, he's not happy, and maybe if it helps you. So, the sabotager comes along, he's Satan, all right? That's why the Bible calls him the adversary, the enemy, the evil one, the tempter. The way he's going to disrupt this peace is to cause a rift between God and man. He wants to tempt man to rebel against God, to fight against God, to go against God. And so he comes along and tempts Adam and Eve to go against the clear prohibition from God, the only prohibition from God. Don't take of the fruit of this tree. Everything you can have, but just not this tree. And the sabotager knew that and came along and says, hey, are you sure God said that? Maybe he doesn't love you. He doesn't want you to be like him. Because he knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be open and you will be like him. He doesn't really love you. Adam and Eve thought for a while and they got sucked into this trap. And so we go to chapter 3. Oh, the sabotager has sabotaged my space. Sorry. The third chapter is that of severance. The peace that man enjoyed is now severed. It's now disrupted, it's now cut off, it's now broken because of sin. And so immediately when you read the Bible, you see Adam begin to hide himself from God. I mean, he was in fellowship with God, sweet bliss, no shame, he was naked and not ashamed, but now he's hiding from God. God says, where are you, Adam? But he wouldn't come. Why? Because everything has now changed. No more peace. But the Bible tells us enemies. Because of our disobedience, because of Adam's sin against God, the whole world today inheriting this sin nature from Adam, we are now all enemies of God. No one is born today. None of us here, we are born today a Christian. No one is born today a friend of God. No one is born today a righteous one. No, why? Because we are all sinners who will rebel against God. In Adam, all are cut off. So the Bible now tells us, because of sin, there is no peace. There is no peace, says the Lord, for the wicked. Sin has ruined it all. Now, what happens after chapter 3, severance, is a sad story now. Would you want to help me with the next S? Separation would be severance, yep. Or separation, that's fine. Excellent, suffering. So the Bible moves and tells us in this story of peace that there is now great suffering. The suffering is very clear that forfeiture, that giving up, that losing of blessing and goodness from God is seen when Adam was chased out. No entry sign, all right? When Adam was chased out of the Garden of Eden. That's a message, that's a picture from God saying, you are out of the blessings of this blessed communion with me. So there are two angels keeping flaming swords at the garden, no entry sign. You're out. Because of your sin, you're out. There's no peace. There's no real blissful, blessed living as it was before. Not only that, the world is now cursed. The whole earth is cursed because of sin. And so the earth, the ground, is cursed with all kinds of thorns and weeds. And now man would have to work very hard. By the way, work is not a bad thing. Work is a good thing. But now men will have to toil, they have to work very hard, a lot of futile work, painful work, because the Bible says, on the sweat of thy brow, you shall eat your bread. It's going to be terrible. Now, the reason why you work so hard today is because of the curse, because of sin. Well, what else did men suffer? Well, God did say to Adam, in the day you shall eat of it, you shall surely die. So suffering involves death. Man dies. And before you die, you get sick, you get old, you decay, your knees don't work very well, your eyesight is terrible, you get lao hua yan, you have pimples, you have whatever. All these things are the result of sin. And so now man is grieved. He's sad. He sheds tears. That's what he will look like. Not only that, if you read on to Genesis 4, the sad reality is because of us being cut off from God, losing peace with God, we lose peace in our heart, we lose a sense of identity, we become envious, jealous, selfish, and murderous. And you will see that Cain would slay his own brother, Abel. That is the picture of man when we lose peace with God, suffering. Well, if the story of peace ends at chapter 4, it will be sad. I think there's nothing for us to talk about this morning. If the story ends here, I think you might as well go home. Don't waste your time. Go play, do whatever you want. But the good news of the Bible is this. The story doesn't end here. The good news of the Bible is chapter 5. Would you like to venture what that word would be? Excellent. The Bible tells us the story of peace goes on to a glorious chapter 5 when Jesus comes. There is salvation. No matter how messed up your life is, no matter how messed up this world is, no matter how deep sin has run, God provides an amazing salvation through His Son, Jesus Christ. That's why the Bible tells us this is why He came, so that He may destroy the works of the devil. Whatever the devil has caused, whatever mess he has created, the Son will come and bring not just restoration, but you will see that what He does and what He accomplishes is far greater, the glory will be far greater than when it began long time ago. That's why the Bible calls Jesus Christ the Prince of Peace. Jesus is the Prince of Peace. See, the Bible is an amazing, multifaceted story of love, of kingdom theology, and also of peace. Jesus is the Prince of Peace. He's going to bring peace to humanity. He's going to bring about reconciliation of man with God. You say, how is He going to do that? Well, He's going to do that by fulfilling justice. Sin has to be paid for. You know, God is so righteous that He wouldn't say, I want peace with man, so whatever they have done wrong, just forget it. I'll just forget it. No. God then would not be righteous. God then would not be just. How can evil just be let off like that or ignored like that? No, it must be satisfied. Evil must be paid for. Justice must be satisfied. And that's why Jesus, the Prince of Peace, will go about restoring man to God through his own sacrifice. He will pay. He will pay it all. He will shed his blood. He will give his life. You say, why is the Christian message about Jesus' sacrifice? Very simple. Jesus sacrificed himself so that God can forgive sinful man. Because if there is no payment, God will be unrighteous to forgive sinful men. So Jesus gives forth his life, sheds his blood on the cross, and he himself is now our peace. You see, men and women can come back to God not because we are good, not because I am good, not because I've done good stuff in my life. There's no good I can do that is acceptable before God. But I can come to God because he is our peace. His work on the cross is credited to my account. What an amazing gift that when I repent and believe in Jesus, he takes my sins, I get that forgiveness. So this is a main teaching in the Bible. Colossians 1:20 says the same, making peace by the blood of his cross. Why? He's reconciling to himself all things. God is bringing the work of reversing this severance. Romans 5:1, I think this could be very clear. It can't be clearer. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Some of you come from different religious backgrounds. You may have thought to have peace with God, to be reconciled with God, to be saved, you need to be a goody-two-shoes, you need to be a good boy, you need to be a religious person, you need to do this, do that, do this, do that. Let me tell you, the Bible says it's not about what you do. It's about what Jesus has done. And you're justified not by works, but by faith. By relying on the finished work of Christ. Now, let me say, if you really repent and believe in Jesus Christ, he changes your heart, and then now you would really start to do good works. But you don't do good works to earn your salvation, but you do it because you just love God. A man is saved by faith without the deeds of the law. That's the amazing message of the Bible. Jesus alone is our peace. So this is a tremendous story of salvation. Now, if it ends here, it is not so exciting. So let me go to chapter 6. In chapter 6, it tells us, now some of you may say, yeah, okay, I believe in Jesus, but it doesn't look that great. I'm still suffering in this world. I am still having to struggle through a lot of things. Let me tell you, the real joy of this blissful living with God again is not going to be seen here. This is a little foretaste, very much mixed with sorrow and pain. But one day, you're going to see the full splendor of peace with God. Splendor will be chapter 6. And so I'm going to erase all that because splendor means everything is new. In Christ, everything is going to be new. And so the picture of peace from that of suffering and agony and grief and sorrow will now be one of delight. And in simple diagram, I'm just going to draw this. God with man. Many of us across the nations, across the generations, all who believe in the promised Savior Jesus Christ, we will be beautifully united in him. That will be the splendor of bliss. I don't think I can draw that splendor. I think the Bible speaks of that splendor, and so let's read it. Behold, the dwelling place of God is with men. Well, it's never been like this since the days of the garden. But now, in the time that is to come, we do not know when this is going to take place, maybe next week, maybe 10 years, maybe 1,000 years from now, I do not know when, but one day it will happen. On that day, the dwelling place of God will be with men. He will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. And there is eternal bliss between God and man. I don't even know what it's going to be like. I don't know what it's going to feel like, look like, smell like, sound like. I don't know. The Bible tells me, no one knows. I have not seen, neither ear heard, neither entered into the hearts of men the things God has prepared for those who love him. I have no clue, but I tell you, it's going to be absolutely spectacular, magnificent, splendid. So we all, in this story of peace, look forward to the end. You know, it's like a good movie. When you watch a movie, you are looking forward to the nice ending. I'm looking forward to chapter 6. So today, where do you live? If you are someone who believes in Jesus Christ, if you're someone who follows Christ, you live somewhere between salvation and splendor. You know, you want to flip the page. Salvation, it's going to flip to chapter 6, but not yet. We are still there in between. So I want to say the last chapter of this story is that whilst we long for this state of splendor, God has left us here for a purpose. This story of peace requires an understanding of God's sending of his people. God has saved us out of this world to remain in this war-torn, peaceless world that we may tell the world the story of peace. That's why you are here. Between salvation and splendor is a distance. And God has left you here, God has left me here, because we have a story to tell to the nations. A story of peace and light. You know, the world today is a war-torn world. Singapore is a war-torn nation. You say, no, where got war? Singapore's so peaceful. Well, external peace, yes. Human peace, yes. National peace, yes. But spiritual peace? No. The world today is still in rebellion, or Singapore today, many people in Singapore today are living in rebellion against God. It's war. We are enemies. And so we are left on this earth for a peace mission, to send the message of peace to those who need it. John Stott, he says, it is the devil who is the troublemaker. You see, it's all the devil's, in a sense, creation. He did it. He tempted Adam and Eve. Of course, our fault is there, but he started that. He's the father of lies, he's the troublemaker. But it is God who loves reconciliation and who now, through his Son, as formerly through his only begotten Son, is bent on making peace. So God sent his Son so that man can have peace with God. And at the very same time, God sends his children, the church, so that man could have peace with God. This morning, I want to say, let me be a peacemaker today. Because some of you right here, maybe hearing this for the very first time, you ask, what is the Bible about? I tell you, the Bible is a good news. It's a good news of love. It's a good news about peace. Not just that peace when you go to Phuket. Not just that peace when you go high up in the mountain, but a real peace you can have with God. And I tell you, this peace is available to you. You say, but I'm a sinner. I'm a terrible, wicked man. I've done many wrong things in my life. That's right. God knows that. And that's why God gave his Son to die for you on the cross. So God today commands you to repent of your sins, commands you to stop rebelling against him. He commands you to say, come and believe in my Son. He has done it all for you. Believe in Him, and you can have everlasting life. This is an amazing good news, don't you realize? We who are sinners, we who are people who will face the fierce wrath of God, we who might face hell forever, God says, I'm willing to save you. I'm willing to have you back. I want to be reconciled with you. I want to have peace with you if only you will repent and believe in my Son. And my friends, there's no other way. Jesus himself said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. I am the only way. I am the Prince of Peace. I'm the only one who shed that blood on the cross, sufficient and capable of washing away all your sins. So this morning, let me be a peacemaker. Would you today repent, come before the Lord in humility, and believe in His Son? That's the story. I'm sent to give. But that's not just a story I'm sent to give. This is a story every one of you who is a child of God, you are sent to give. That's why Jesus says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. This is such an urgent and important message. You know, it's so sad when in comfortable Singapore, we have all kinds of things that become our priority. Let me ask you, what are the top five priorities in your life right now? If I were to ask you, what are the top five priorities right now, what would register in your mind straight away? Career, bills, kids, family. But where is that missional understanding? Where is that appreciation that we who are destined for splendor are sent on a mission, and we must be faithful to that mission? But the Bible says all this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to Himself. You can give this message because you know this message. You have been reconciled to God through Jesus Christ. You have understood what it means to believe in Him. Your life has been changed. You see the fruit of God in your life. You have been so transformed and say, God is in me. I have been reconciled with God. Then go and fulfill the ministry of reconciliation. Go tell others about Jesus. That's what He's saying. Now, I know some of you may not want to tell that story. You may not want to evangelize. You don't want to tell others because you don't like to be labeled as a troublemaker. You know, people who share the gospel, the world generally sees Christians as troublemakers. They want to tell me about my sin, about Jesus again. They're so troubling. They're so irritating. I don't like to hear that message. But let me remind you, now, of course, if you are very rude and very disrespectful, then you deserve to be scolded. But if you are respectful and you are considerate and you give a factual, honest representation of the story of peace, I want to say you cannot be called a troublemaker. Why? Because the original troublemaker is Satan. He's the troublemaker, not us. We are doing the work of reconciliation. I suppose it's like this. I have two boys. Sometimes I bring them to see the doctor, and I don't think they really like to see the doctor. They say, doctor, I don't want, especially the younger one. I don't like the doctor. Why? Well, because his experience with the doctor is that maybe he takes a cold stethoscope and puts it all over his chest, very uncomfortable. He remembers the doctors or the nurses would take a needle and poke him, take blood. He remembers maybe the vaccination, pop his backside, and so his association with doctors is a negative experience. They are bad. But is it really the doctor's fault? Are you troubled by this question? I mean, is it really the doctor's fault? No, of course not. The trouble is with the disease. What the doctor is doing is good. It's reconciling me or reconciling Matthias to good health. The problem is not the doctor, the problem is the disease. But what the doctor does in order to get me well can be sometimes very uncomfortable and painful, but it is still good. See, when I was a doctor, I never have a problem poking babies. Please don't imagine I'm a sadistic doctor, but I look at it reasonably. I'm not like rough with the kid, poke, 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 yeah. No, no, I'm not doing that. I understand that I have to be gentle, and I try to be gentle, nice with the kids, but I know that with this poke, I know it's not nice, but it's good for him. And even if the baby cries, wah, wah, and he hates me forever, so be it. I'm here to help you. You know, Christians, you are given the ministry of reconciliation. Now, the message you bring is going to hurt people because you're telling them that they are sinners. You're telling them that for their sins, they will be damned in eternal hell fire forever. You're telling them that they are so hopeless, they cannot save themselves. You're telling them to bow before Jesus and to believe and to belong and to follow Jesus. That's hard. That's uncomfortable. Truth hurts, but it's for their good. And so, whilst the world may not appreciate it, the messengers of peace understand the need for it. And the messengers of peace give forth this message uncompromisingly. We don't back down. We don't try to reduce the standard. We don't try to reduce the requirements of the gospel to repent, to die to yourself, and to follow Jesus. No, we don't minimize that. We give a clear message. Why? Because that's the message from the King. I like what Tozer said. A.W. Tozer, he says, we are not diplomats. In other words, we are not here trying to be political, nice, win everybody. No, we are not diplomats, but we are prophets. Our message is not a compromise, but an ultimatum. The gospel is an ultimatum. I told you that the Bible can be looked at in different angles, one of which is that of a king issuing a message of repentance. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is coming near. His point is when that kingdom is going to be ushered in, those who are rebels will be judged. So repent. It's an ultimatum. There's no compromise. There's no negotiation. It's clear. I think the idea is that of ancient peacemakers. In ancient times, ambassadors would be sent forth by the king to rebel states and call them to come back to the king. Put down your arms, repent, and the king will forgive. That's the job of the peacemaker. Uncompromising. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes that rebel state may just grab the ambassador and chop off his head. And you know, that's what being a peacemaker entails. That's what it said in verse 10. When you are being an ambassador for God, don't expect success all the time. Don't expect people to embrace you all the time. It's not going to happen. Sometimes it's going to be wonderful. People will repent, like when Jonah preached, the whole city of Nineveh repented. Wonderful. But there are times where, like Paul, he's hunted and harassed like an animal. He's persecuted for righteousness' sake. But the man on a mission understands that. He's sent to a war-torn world anyway, and his eyes are fixed on the heavenly splendors that are to come. My friends, we have an unmatched message to tell the world. There's no message like ours. There's no message like that from the Bible. Yesterday was SAF Day, right? And it was NS50. It was a celebration of our national service, celebration of the Singapore Armed Forces. And I think we are thankful as a nation for the good job the military has done, given us many peaceful days and years. But let me tell you something SAF will never be able to do. SAF or NS will never be able to bring about real peace with God. SAF and NS will never bring about peace that lasts forever. Praise God for generals, for defense ministers, whatever. But I think the child of God has a superb message that outstrips all those. Now, I'm not running it down, but I'm saying how valuable, how precious is that mission God has sent us on. And some of us are craving to be somebody in society, somebody, and we forget that we are ambassadors of the heavenly King. Wow. And this message of peace is so powerful. It does not just heal our relationship with God. You know, this message of peace can bring nations together, bring people together. It's so powerful. Ephesians 2:14, the Bible says, He Himself is of peace. Christ is of peace, who has made us both one. What Paul is saying here is, made both the Jews and the Gentiles one family, one body. A more intimate picture. Jews and Gentiles, they hate each other. They don't like each other. But because of Christ, historical, deep-rooted animosity is melted away and the people become one in the love of God. Because we are united through Christ to the Father, we are now brothers and sisters in Christ. That's amazing. That's what SAF, that's what our ambassadors, that's what our politicians will never be able to achieve. But that's the message God gives to you to share, to give to your neighbors, to give to your loved ones, to give to the people all across the world. Unmatched message. So no wonder Isaiah exclaims, "How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him who brings good news, who publishes peace, who brings good news of happiness, who publishes salvation, who says to Zion, your God reigns." This is a picture of a man who is on a mission. He's like an ambassador from a far, far away land. He runs, he makes his way all the way across the lands, across the seas, climbs the mountains, and from a distance, people could see him coming to us. He says, how wonderful! The King has sent a message of peace. We who have been hiding from our King, we who are living in misery in our own devices, we now can get back to our King. How beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. Christians must have such beautiful feet. I'm not asking you to go pedicure, but I'm asking you to short your selves with, or arm yourselves with the gospel and go where God wants you to go. To tell people good news. There is peace. Now, some people may throw eggs at you. That's fine. They don't appreciate that good news. But one day it will be all so clear. But you go. Go tell people. Go tell people a great story today. I think this is the verse. I think these are the teachings that inspire missionaries across the ages to go across the globe. They leave their families. They leave their careers. By the way, I'm not talking fairy tale. I know that when I hear people talk about, oh, missionaries leave their homes, leave their careers, I almost think fairy tale. In Hokkien, we say hao xiao. Ridiculous one, where got such thing? Well, I think it's true throughout church history, even right up to today, there are people who leave everything because they are bringing good news to people all across the world. You see, they are very clear. They are very clear that they have been beautifully saved. They are very clear that they are living for a splendor up there and not for comfort right now. And therefore, they know they are sent. This is very clear, that they will devote their whole life to fulfilling this mission. Maybe some of you today, God is speaking to you to be sent somewhere. To go where no one has gone with the gospel. Well, when you do that, people around you will say, surely he's the Son of God. No one would have done that. But maybe for us, many of us, this is a step too far. Then I say, take little steps for now. Take little steps to be sending the message of the good news to your neighbor, to your friends, to your colleagues. Tell them about Jesus. Tell them about the peace that they have lost. Tell them about the peace that they can have. Tell them about this peace that will transform everything. Maybe some of you say, yeah, I really want to share the gospel, but I don't know how to. I'm glad you asked. Advertisement time. Please join us for express training in October. And I say it's funny in a sense, but I'm dead serious about it. You know, one thing I really wish all of us would at least have is to be equipped in sharing the gospel. Now, some of you are already very comfortable in sharing your faith. Fantastic. Then I say, that's fine. You don't really need to come for training unless you feel that you may want to learn another tool, pick up another way of sharing the gospel. But I'm speaking to many who may not really know how to even start a conversation to share the gospel. I'm talking to people who feel scared about taking that first step. But then I say to you, would you at least do yourself a favor to be trained? I think Gospel Light would be a very different church if you, I'm talking about you, or I'm not talking about him or her, I'm talking about you. If you are equipped to be able to share this story of peace, this gospel to others, this church will be very different. I guarantee you, within a year, it will be very different. If every single one of us realize we are being sent, this church will be different. But I say to you, advertisement time, come join us in October. I really hope that our church will equip you. At least that's our responsibility. We provide the training, and if you come, that's great. If you don't come, the blood is on your head. So we hope to run this at least twice a year, God willing. But it's so important for us to be equipped to share the good news of Jesus Christ. Well, this is what makes us identifiable. When we are going about the work of peacemaking, the Bible says they shall be called the sons of God. Now, the word sons is the word Greek word huios, which there are different words for the word children or sons in the Bible, but the word huios leans more towards that of an offspring. It leans more towards the idea that this person has taken on the characteristic, the likeness of God. In other words, when we are going about peacemaking, you are easily identified as being a child of God. It's recognizable through your life. And I suppose that's why people will persecute you when you are so identifiable. So my friends, your life can be about this peace. What would you want to have on your tomb when you die? A man who has been rich, successful, 10 cars, 5 condos. Think about your legacy. Think about what you're living for. I end with this story of this man named Alfred. Lived some time ago. One day he was in France, Paris. He was reading the newspaper and he came to the obituary section and to his surprise, he saw his own name. Someone has written that he has died. He was horrified. He says, no, I didn't die. Well, actually what happened is that his brother, Ludwig, had died. But the editor of the papers got it wrong and thought it was him, Alfred, who died. And so he read the obituary with these words, the merchant of death is dead. You see, Alfred is known as the merchant of death because he was the inventor of dynamite. He was the one who people say have given us weapons to kill many at one go. He's called the merchant of death. He has factories that manufacture dynamite. And when he read it, he was horrified. It went on to say, Dr. Alfred Nobel, who became rich by finding ways to kill more people faster than ever before, died yesterday. To his horror, he said, is this the legacy I will leave behind? Now, whether this story is real or not, I really cannot verify. Some say it's real, some say it's not, but it's a good story, all right? But he said, I don't want to be remembered this way. And that is how the Nobel Peace Prize came about. But someone had a check on his life and decided to change direction. I wish today Christians would have this wisdom to learn from Alfred Nobel. It's easy to rush along life, not knowing where we are going. But today, take stock. We are a people saved from the sufferings of sin. We are a people heading for a place of splendor, of eternal bliss. Hey, let's be faithful living this mission of giving the story of peace. I thought about how to end this sermon, and I thought one of the best ways is to give you a song. Not that I'll sing it, but to remind you of this song. We have sung this song like 18, 19, 20 years ago in gospel. Like, I have not heard this song since then. Anybody knows what the song would be? I actually hinted at just now. Okay, never mind. I took a long time to think about it. Anyway, the song is appropriate. It's called "With a Story to Tell to the Nations." Look at the lyrics. "With a story to tell to the nations that shall turn their hearts to the right. A story of truth and mercy, a story of peace and light. With a song to be sung to the nations that shall lift their hearts to the Lord. A song that shall conquer evil and shatter the spear and sword." No more wars. "What a message, with a message to give to the nations that the Lord who reigns above hath sent his Son to save us and show us that God is love. With a Savior to show to the nations who the path of sorrow hath trod, he hath gone that suffering way, so that all of the world's great peoples might come to the truth of God. With a story to tell to the nations that shall turn their hearts to the right, a story of truth and mercy, a story of peace and light." That's the story of the Bible. Let's bow for a word of prayer together. I just want to give you this time to think and reflect, because I've told you a story of peace. And I pray this morning some of you right here will seriously consider this message, this ultimatum from the Father, from God the King. He commands men everywhere to repent. Would you do so before the King? Would you rely and believe in the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross? This morning, it might be the day of you coming to experience this peace in your heart. So I pray you repent, you believe in Christ, who is the Prince of Peace. I want to speak today also to Christians, because you may be here and you are happy and going about life as usual. And you know, the danger of gospel-like Christian church is that we can easily become gospel-like Christian club. Comfortable, cozy, air-conditioned, nice chairs, neat and clean faith. Just come on Sunday, hear a sermon, go back, go about my own business. This is life. That is not life. That's an abuse of life. Because God has given you this life, sent you here for a mission. To be shod with this beautiful feet, to be using your beautiful feet to go all across maybe your office, your school, your neighborhood, and to herald the gospel of peace. Would you do that? Because you know you are saved. You have been reconciled. Because you know you're destined for glory to come, so what's there to lose? Because you know Christ is with you as you go about making disciples. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. Father, thank you for this story we can tell to the nations. I pray people here today will receive this message well. And I pray gospel light will really be the light to bring this message of peace, this message of light to all around us. God, spare us from being a comfortable, mundane, selfish people, but make us missional. make us peacemakers. Work in our hearts this day. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, thanks for watching. We hope it has been a blessing. For more of such content, do check out our website and our YouTube channel. And do subscribe for weekly updates. May God bless you.